Yes, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another video entitled Bits and Pieces on the Second Coming of Jesus. And some of the questions I'll be looking at include, is the Church Jesus Christ's bride? Second, what is Jesus coming to earth for the second time? Three, what will be the ecology? What will be the setting of the ecology at Jesus' second coming? Four, will Jesus live in temple made with human hands when he comes the second time? And three, what will be the fate of the sons and daughters of the children of Israel, of biblical Israel? Now, the music and the background is, the song is My Name Written There by M.A. Kidder from hymnary.org. And the first question beginning, and may the God give us peace, patience, as we concentrate. The first question, Jesus Church as bride. And as we see there in the picture, we see Jesus with his outstretched hands, and the lady in white symbolically or metaphorically represented bride, the lady, and Jesus, the husband, coming to meet his bride. And Jesus, and we have two representation of the bride. One of them you will see later down in the presentation, but this first one we are looking at the church as the bride. In Revelation chapter 19, we see verses 7 to 9, and it reads from verse 7, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife had made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. Blessed are they which are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And in Revelation 14, we see written, I think Revelation 14, I can't remember the exact, or maybe 14, 12, I can't remember the exact verse. And it said, blessed are they who wash their robes. Alright? So there is that emphasis on the character and preparedness. So the character is righteousness of the saints. So holy living is of significance. Character development. And we also see readiness. Okay? So these are important qualifications for the bride of Jesus Christ. Now, as we continue, the second question, what is Jesus coming to earth for the second time? Alright, so we see a bit on this one. We see harvest and reward. So these are the two areas we'll be looking at. Now, the summary of Matthew 13, 24 to 50, Jesus, in the parable of the wheat and the tares, says, the wheat and the tares must grow together to avoid mistaken identities until the time of harvest. At such time, the Son of Man, who is Jesus, shall send his angels, shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity, and give reward to the good, and repair the wicked to hell and destruction with Satan and his angels, according to Revelation 19 and 20, which tells us about Satan and his destruction together with the angels, and then all who do wickedly. So we see that here Jesus will take his own initiative to separate the quality of people or persons that will get reward. Alright? So the wicked will get the reward of destruction. But the destruction of the wicked is coming not at the same time with the righteous. They will come after. Alright. And then we have the good. And so the good ones, which will be the saints, will be going home with Jesus. As we see in 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 to 18, and it says that God will resurrect his dead saints who accepted his Son, his Son's salvation, that is the salvation that Jesus Christ offered from sin, and lived and honored him while they were alive. And the saints alive will be changed and join with the resurrected saints to meet Jesus in the air and travel to heaven with him. And 1 Corinthians 15 also speaks to the resurrection and the change the human body will experience, having gotten the reward of eternal life. So two things will be involved: the resurrection of the dead saints and the change of the mortal, the dead, dying state to a state of immortality, according to 1 Corinthians 15. And together they will meet the Lord in the air. Alright? And their reward will be eternal life. Now, let us look at the setting of the ecology at Jesus' coming, according to Revelation 16, where we see the plagues. Now, this ecology has to do with the whole nature, the natural environment, the organisms, the people, community, and so on. So we're talking about everything, all right? And this brings us to the plagues, because we see this happening at the time, just prior to the coming of Jesus. So for this one, I want you to hear the plagues. So we will read Revelation chapter 16, okay? Beginning from verse 1, it says, and I heard a great voice out of the temple saying, to the seven angels, go your way. And sorry for that. Go your ways and pour out the vials of God upon the earth. And the first angel went and poured out his vial upon the earth. And there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men. And this will be, well, which had the mark of the beast. And men there could be representative of generic man, representing both men, women, and children, maybe, which had the mark of the beast. So you notice that? Those that had the mark of the beast. And upon them which worship his image. So we have here, worship his image and take the mark. And the second angel poured out his vial upon the sea, and it became as a dead man. And every living soul died in the sea. And the third angel poured out his vial upon the rivers and fountains of waters, and they became blood. And I heard the angel of the waters say, Thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and was, and shall be, because Thou hast judged us. For they have shed the blood of the saints and prophets, and Thou hast given them blood to drink, for they are worthy. And I heard another out of the altar say, Even so, Lord, Almighty, true and righteous are thy judgments. And the fourth angel poured out his vial upon the sun, and power was given unto him on the sun to scorch men with fire. And men were scorched with great heat, and blasphemed the name of God, which had power over these plagues. And they repented not to give him glory. And the fifth angel poured out his vial upon the sea, the seat of the beast. And his kingdom was full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues for pain, and blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and repented not of their deeds. And the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon. And out of the mouth of the beast. And out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are the spirits of devils, working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon. And the seventh angel poured out his vial in the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven, from the throne, saying, It is done. And there were voices and thunders and lightning, and there was a great earthquake such as was not since men were upon the face of the earth. So mighty an earthquake, and so great. And the great city was divided into three parts, And the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon came in remembrance before God, to give unto her the cup of the wine of her fierceness, of his wrath. And every island fled away, the mountains were not found. And there fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent. And men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was great. So, ladies and gentlemen, what we see from this Revelation 16 is basically the fact that presently and continuing, the earth, well, in the past too, you know, but we have a matter of repetition and enlargement, so it continues at present and will continue to the end. The ruling of the beast. Yes, the ruling of the beast in Revelation 13, which governs in policy, whose policies govern or is forced upon all nations of the world. And as we see here from the writing, particularly that element of the mark of the beast, the number given in the hand or in the forehead, and the worship of the beast, which deals with a public day. And men and women and children who obey such command against God's command will receive the plague. There will be no salvation. So sometimes people do not understand, and when they are given information concerning obedience to God and their own personal defense, they get angry and they even persecute. But God has given his commandments to guide humanity, and humanity is judged by them, and deliverance will also come from the knowledge in terms of decision making. The mark of the beast. The Bible says the same, fear God and worship him as creator. And that we should be careful concerning the socio-economics being forced upon us as it relates to buying and selling in the future, according to the beast's command. Because the beast says, if you don't obey him or her, that system of government, you will not be able to buy or sell. So people have to make the decisions as to whether or not they will take the mark and worship and receive the plague. So Revelation 16 is a very important chapter. But we don't hear them talking about this in a lot of the pulpits. What we hear is a social gospel and prosperity, right? So this is very important. Another very important area is the natural disasters. Humanity, you know, promises and they are due a lot of technological advancement, particularly in the area of construction, I would like to see now, where buildings are constructed. You know, great structures, great architecture, I mean, particularly the structural area, all right, to deal with earthquakes and hurricanes and flooding and so forth. But when these natural disasters occur, we see that the hands of men are tied. Mankind's hands are tied. The scientists, everybody, their hands are tied as they stand and watch the massive disasters that come about by these floods and earthquakes and so on. So God has said that we must not put full confidence in man. Well, he said, your confidence in man. And even the psychologists say that we must not believe 100%, leave room for disappointments. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we must leave room also to critically assess situations. All right? Not just jump on the bandwagon. So continuing, I think that is the area I want to because we see at the coming, all these things will dissolve by a massive great earthquake and flooding at the coming of Jesus. Buildings will fall, say the mountains will be flat. So ladies and gentlemen, as we live here and we occupy and we build, let us have moderation in our thinking and the way we do things, and also the reverence for God, because God's word stands. So now let us look now at Jesus' bride B, the New Jerusalem City. So the first part with this bride was the second coming of Jesus, removing the sins from the earth, we take them to heaven, 1,000 years, the Bible says, sin. And then, now we have the New Jerusalem City, which, and here, so it's answering the question one, the bride, the B, the New Jerusalem City, and then we have question four, where Jesus lived in temples made with human hands, when he comes the second time. We see, for example, and hear about the talk of the building of the third temple. And, you know, basically the preparation of Israel for a temple so that Messiah will dwell. But let us see what the Bible tells us here. Revelation 21 and 22 says, the New Jerusalem in heaven is termed the bride of Christ. So the saints now, they are up in heaven after taken from earth. And so now we see the emphasis now turn from the church on earth to the New Jerusalem. So let's see what's happening there. The New Jerusalem in heaven is termed the bride of Christ. The children of biblical Israel and the apostles of Jesus Christ are associated with the foundation. The apostles is with the foundation. And the gates at the entrance, we have Israel to the city, giving assurance that God remembers Jacob. And not only Jacob, but it's the beginning covenant with Abraham. And we have symbol inside, associated with the city in Jerusalem. We have the apostles, which are the foundation members, and we have the biblical children of Israel at the gates. The names of each we will see are at the gates. And the tree of life we also see in the city. Now that tree of life was referenced early in the book of Genesis, associated with the story of evil, when evil entered, or sin, when sin entered in Eden. All right? It's associated with, you know, we have the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. So in picture form now, we have, if we should have it, we have, coming in from bin.com, the Jerusalem city, according to Revelation 21, is coming down from heaven. And so the arrow points, you see the red arrow pointing to the city, and the city is coming down. According to Revelation 21, the city has no temple, the city has no sun or moon, and the city has no light, because God and Jesus are the light, or is the light. Alright? So there is no need of moon, nor sun, nor night. And there is no temple there. Jesus is the temple. And God the Father is also the temple. And so the city is coming down, according to Revelation 21, towards earth. And it's not this old earth, it is the new earth that God will make. The Bible says that God will make a new heaven and a new earth. So the city of the New Jerusalem is coming down from heaven, out of God, on towards the new earth. Now let us look now at the city's dimension, the dimension of the New Jerusalem city. We have the length, the breadth, and the height. That's the same. 1,500 miles by 1,500 miles by 1,500 miles. It's written, it's actually in cubits, but this is the mathematical equivalent. And so we have an area which is length by breadth. That's the like the floor plan, the floor, length by breadth. An area of, that is 1,500 miles multiplied by 1,500 miles, length and breadth, give you an area of 2,250,000 square miles, and we put the height onto that to get the cubic or the volume of the city, which is 3,375 million cubic miles. So you can get a lot of what you call going up, those levels going up. Can get a lot of levels going up to house. And the wall, that is the outer wall, the wall of the city, it's equal to or less than 72 yards. Alright, you read the text, this is the mathematical, the metric, 72, the current conversion, about 72 yards, which is something like about somewhere in the region of 210 feet. Because 3 feet is about 3 feet is a yard. Yes, 3 feet is a yard. So about within the region it could be more, 210 feet. So look at that thickness of the wall. And there are 12 gates. We see the 12 gates. Let's just look back at that 12 gates. We have three on each. We have three to the north, three to the south, three to the east, three to the west. Those small openings. These are the walls at the bottom. I don't know if you can see them. These are the entrance. And on the each of the gates is the name of each of the children of Israel. That's biblical Israel. Okay? And we also have 12 angels One at each gate, which is significant because we see in the earlier on in Matthew that God sending angels to actually separate the wheat and the tares. Okay? So we have some angels here. And the question is whether these angels will be used to gather the sons and daughters wherever they are on the earth. That's the question. And then we also have 12 foundations. And on these foundations, we have the names of the apostles. Right? Okay? So, again we have it. On 12 gates to the entrance, the New Jerusalem coming down out of God from heaven onto the new earth. And each name of the children of Jacob is written on each gate, symbolizing remembrance of that covenant that God had made, you know, in relation to salvation. And there we have the apostles there, you know. I like this picture of the adventure we get on the sea with the boat. So we have there that one symbolic of Peter outside of the boat coming to meet Jesus walking on the water. And just like that. And then in the city we also have the tree of life that we see in Revelation 22, the tree of life. Now they tell us, Revelation 22 tells us that there's a throne of God, and flowing from the throne is this river. And so flowing from the throne is this river, and on the sides of this river, on the both sides, we have the tree of life. Now this is the artist's symbolism, but we don't see any fruit. But it tells us that the tree bears 12 manner of fruit each month. So you can imagine. They also tell us that the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nation. And so this is the attempt of man to symbolize what the chapter is saying. So ladies and gentlemen, I have a video there termed the greatest scientific research, and that is dealing with the tree of life. And those of you who actually do research and want to know how to do the development you can look at it, because you can get some help in terms of your planning. So when we come to question 5, what will be the fate of the sons and daughters of the children of Israel? Now, let me go back a little bit something. Just I realize that I should have emphasized the fact that this is the reward. You know, we have the reward, so the life in the New Jerusalem, that is the reward, the eternal life. And we see Jesus is with the people. So in terms of the question as to whether or not God will be living in temples made with human hands, and the answer is no, okay? God will bring his own city with him, and he will also make a new earth. Okay, so what will be the fate of the sons and daughters of the children of biblical Israel? All right, we see just in memory that these, the names of the biblical Israel is written down on the entrance of the gates of the city, right? So, we see here that God maintained, right, his commitment He didn't change. Right? He didn't change. Even we have Israel changing, God did not change. So Isaiah 49 and the biblical Israel, let's see what Isaiah 49 says. Isaiah 49 shows that God did not succeed in gathering biblical Israel at the time of Jesus. As we know, and we see Psalms 22 is a testimony of that. But the glory of Jesus' sacrifice was achieved by the grafting and acceptance of the Gentiles. So ladies and gentlemen, this is some, let's stick a little pin here, because this is a point that a lot of people do not understand or think about at all. God had this covenant with Israel, starting from Abraham, and he renewed with Isaac and Jacob. The same salvation covenant, until the time when Jesus came to ratify the covenant. Israel by that time had moved away from God's ordinance, the way how God's will, I should say, and having their own interpretation of things. And so they misconstrued everything, and the leaders led the people away from God. So God was not able to succeed. They denied Jesus, and with the Romans, killed him. Because it was both the rabbis and the Romans' collaboration. They killed him. Now, so they didn't understand, right? They didn't understand. You hear Jesus say on the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." No, that immediately puts that continuation of that covenant in terms now of the responsibility of building up the kingdom Jesus had established, you know, the church with the gospel ministry and so forth to go forth. Because we saw in the book of Acts that the Jews continue to make problems, right, with the Gentiles so much that God had to just, you know, discipline them badly. Now, that was a problem because the Jews did not stand in a position for the continuity of this whole thing with Jesus. So what we have here now was a need, a covenant need. Adjustment. We need adjustment. Now we saw this adjustment, like plan B, maybe, with the selection of the 12 disciples who will now become the administrators of the church. Alright? And the administrative, carrying on the gospel, building up the kingdom of God. Until they died in the first century. We saw Satan brutally trying to wipe out the church through the centuries with the beast system that was prophesied, all right, with Rome, and coming down the centuries when the Vatican ruled, you know, the whole, and taking over the rulership of both church and state. You know, we saw it. History showed us. It is clear. And we saw many changes and some taking place. Now the question is, if God does not take a stand, who will? Is he just going to leave the church at stake? We see men rising up, men like Martin Luther, all right, and other guys, where they had the separation from Rome, all right, where we had now that they had other religious organizations, we call them Protestants, Protestants in England and in Germany and over Europe and so on, all right, and these men in the beginning And they you know, they continue the gospel, continue with the truth and so on. And, but as we come down the line, we see changes, right? We see changes, right? So God now had to continue to make new call and new preparation to protect his church, all right? Which he did. We called prophets, and we had this, we had prophets coming down, major prophets, and he gave them clarity. And we see a lot of major prophets associated with United States, where the beast had continued, and we had E.G. White, and we had other major theologians. She was not the prophet that was first called, but she's the one who answered after, I think, God's attempt with two sets of other people, I think. And so we saw the development of and the changes in the whole of America, you know, the health, and you know, we saw the doctrines and different things, the schools, and you know, because the system was bad subsequent to slavery. So we see a lot of work done, and then we see mission extended to the other parts. Alright? So but what we have is that some of the Protestants changed and went back to the Vatican. Alright? And currently, as we saw in the current times, as we saw in COVID, and they also went, not only them, but the other religions and so on, went and committed themselves to the Vatican, right? And the Vatican, the Bible talks about as the beast system, together with the strengthening of another beast, or government, the United States, which strengthened the hands. So we see by going back to the Vatican, that is not in God's favor. That is not in the favor of the Church of Jesus Christ. Alright? Because the beast is associated with Satan. We see in the plagues, we saw three spirits coming out. We see the dragon, which represents Satan. We saw the beast, which represents that same system of the Vatican beginning, and it's two, the first one and the second one from the government within the United States. They will merge, same beast, same agenda, they merge. And so the beast, the dragon, gave the beast a seat, and we also have the prophets, right? So the beast act the agenda of the dragon, and the prophets, the false prophets, I should say, the false prophets, they also act the agenda of the beast. So what you find happening is that the whole world is governed by the devil, Satan, under the beast and the false prophets. So, who is representing God? That is the question. In the book of the same, I think Revelation 13 or 14, or 12, between 12 and 14, it is talked about, here are they that keep the commandments of God. So, the biblical system that is teaching you to obey the commandments of God, to worship God, not part of it, but all of it, you need to know that, all of it, because we need to be able to protect and defend ourselves from the evil one through our knowledge of Scripture. So we must know the truth, because the truth will set us free. Alright, ladies and gentlemen, so apart from the fact that we have the social gospel, we must be concerned with knowing what is the truth. Alright, because it is the truth that will set us free. It is the truth that will cause us not to accept the beast and not to worship the beast and accept his image. And so you need to ask yourself, who is it rich among the lot are teaching the truth from the Bible that will set us free, that will help us to open our eyes against the deception of the evil one? This is the question, ladies and gentlemen. We must be guided by the Bible, because we see that the false prophets go back and is being governed under the agenda and governing the people under a satanic agenda. So the Gentiles, right? So there's need for adjustment of the covenant. God must have a representative in the land. God will have prophets to guide the people. Why should Satan have all these prophets guiding the people wrongly and God have none? Ladies and gentlemen, you think God will stand for that? Just watch and let his harvest go to nothing? No! The Gentiles, the Bible said, will be kind to the sons and daughters of biblical Israel. Continuing with Isaiah 49, let's see that in verse 22 to 23. And God will do his own intervention as Savior and Redeemer for of Jacob's Israel. Okay? So when we look, right, and we see that in verse 49, 20, 40, 26, and I think there's another passage, I think in Isaiah 19, that also talks about the whole covenant with Abraham, right? So the whole idea is that some people just think exclusively because they have the benefit of the gospel that they, you know, they are God's privileged people because of the benefit of the gospel and the truth. But the truth matter is that biblical Israel is the root of the Christian covenant. Jesus said it in his own mouth when he was talking with a woman of Samaria, I think, when he was talking about worship. He said that you worship, you know not what. Salvation is of the Jews. Biblical Israel is the root of the Christian covenant, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, they deny Jesus Christ. Yes. But we see God being consistent with the promise or the contract he had made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He never changed on the covenant. It's the people that change. But God didn't change. He remembered them. The Gentiles are the branches grafted into the root. So the Gentiles get the benefit. And we hear Paul telling them, Gentiles in the book of Acts, do not boast. Alright? But God, we see in the book of Revelation 21 that God remembers the biblical covenant on, well, in that we don't see that we don't see that now. God remembers the biblical covenant on Jesus' breast on his high priest clothing. You know, in let's look at it now. If you look at the high priest, this is the priest here, it's small, but the other things are big enough. In Exodus 28:17, when he was he told Moses exactly, you know, the garments and everything, which was based on the heavenly vision. And on the breastplate, right, on the breastplate, the chest of the priest, the chest, the whole front, the chest, the breastplate, they wore the names of the 12 sons of Jacob, the children of Israel, all right? And there was also, in the breastplate, it had the gold plated, and engraved in the gold was a metal for each one of the sons, all right? And so the same imagery, well, not the same imagery, but it could be, I don't know. On the entrance of the gate in the New Jerusalem city, we have the names of the of each of the tribes. So there's a possibility that there is a jewel, all right, for each, that is their representative, and the same as the breastplate. So the information as one on the breastplate of the high priest, we see on the entrance, the names of the children of Israel, and the entrance of the new, of the gates of the New Jerusalem city. That has to be significant, ladies and gentlemen, because humans usually think that their logics could fit God's, but neither the logic of the head nor the feeling of the heart could fit God. God is a most tender person, more than a human being can, you know, feel. And the brain of God, we cannot fit to that. The imagination of God, we cannot even imagine, begin to imagine what God will do, what he will think, and what he will feel. People think that, well, they usually have this need, I don't know where they get it from, to want to hold everything in their pocket. And so whatever they can't control in their pocket, is they will dismiss. All right, so God is in their pocket and they can hold him there. And whoever has a different thought to that, they will dismiss it. But God is not like that. You know, God is not like that at all. God is much, much, much different. So in summary, God is in charge of the events of human history. Despite the efforts of humanity to live outside of God's will, seemingly offering a better future for human satisfaction, God keeps his focus for his church on earth and will execute judgment on all who act against his administrative will, and we see that in the plagues. The saints of God must live holy lives while waiting for the coming of Jesus to give reward of eternal life. And we see that in Revelation 21. Oh, yes, with the bride. Is it Revelation 21? Yeah. Not sure. And the earth in its present corrupt state is not the future home of Jesus and his saints. So the idea of building temple in Israel is outside of God's business. The Bible says that God will make a new earth and the new Jerusalem city in heaven will come down and dwell on earth, and God will dwell with his saints in a bliss of righteousness, and that is after the destruction of the wickedness, and the new earth Destruction of the wicked is in Revelation 19 and 20, and then falling with the new earth after the reign of 1,000 years in heaven, when the saints are taken up. So Jesus invites all of humanity. Ladies and gentlemen, when Jesus Christ died, he died for humanity. He invites all of humanity. Yes, the covenant came to Israel, and Israel had a responsibility, and Israel severed that responsibility as a nation. Okay, and they were greatly disciplined for that. All right, God will take, they are God's own initiative. God will take initiative for them. As we see, they are remembered, the sons and daughters are remembered. Just when God took Israel out of Egypt, there was unbelief in their fathers, their ancestors, and God had to make them go through for 40 years in the deserts. And then the children got the inheritance. Likewise, or similarly, the sons of God, the children of Israel at the time of Jesus, who held the covenant and was responsible, they disbelieved, and again they were discounted. But the sons and daughters and the Gentiles got the benefits, but it was also prophesied that the sons and daughters, the Gentiles will take the sons and daughters like babes in their hands. So God has made salvation available for all and sundry. And he says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart as was done in the earlier period, where we see what happened. God wants all of us to be saved. So ladies and gentlemen, let us be wise and make wise decisions so that we will receive the reward of eternal life. And God will also be happy. Until the next video, may God be with you.